So you've decided you want a BMW Retro Boxer Twin, but there are four in the R9T lineup and you might not know which one to pick. But fear not, I've got all of them here today. I'm gonna run through the specs of each and tell you which kind of rider might buy each bike. But before we get started, a big thank you to Dick Lovett Motorrad here just outside Bristol. If you fancy test riding any of these bikes, they've got a great showroom here, plenty of good roads nearby, and I'm sure they'll be more than willing to help you out. So hit the link in the description if you want to try one out. So as usual, we'll go in price order ascending, starting with the R9T that sits at the bottom of the range. But just because it's the entry point doesn't mean you're going to get some kind of budget knockoff version. The fundamentals of this bike are the same as the others. You just get a more premium spec as you move up through the range. So you do get the 1170cc boxer twin, and it still makes 109 horsepower at 7,250 RPM. Now that's really pretty good for the retro segment, up over 100 horsepower. I mean, there's really only the Japanese retros like the Z900 RS or the XSR 900, but those are fundamentally based on a modern bike with a bit of a retro body kit. This is purely retro, an air and oil cooled engine, and for this genre of bike, 109 horsepower is really pretty good. It also makes 116 newton meters of peak torque at 6,000 RPM, and the delivery of power on these bikes is like really linear. It just goes and goes and goes right up to that peak power figure. You've got a single plate dry clutch with a hydraulic actuation through a shaft drive to the rear wheel, so it really does have that BMW feel when you ride it. And it's all housed in a three-piece frame, nice and low slung, with a seat height of 805 millimeters, so pretty accessible even for shorter riders. Now, it's not super light, but 219 kilograms curb weight is pretty manageable for most of us as well, so I'd say that this is a great choice if you're a bit intimidated by the taller, heavier bikes. In terms of suspension, you've got a 43 mil right way up fork, and then there's a monoshock at the rear. There's no adjustment in the fork, but the monoshock is preload and rebound adjustable, and it's also got a new linkage design on the shock for 2021, which they say gives a more comfortable ride. Brakes are from Brembo, and they're four pot on 320 mil discs. They're not the most premium spec Brembos you'll ever find, but I think they've got plenty of power for sort of general road riding and even pushing on a little bit. You get cast wheels on this version, although you can spec it up with spokes, 17 inch front and rear of course, and they're shod with Bridgestone T31s. And you also get a single Akrapovic exhaust on this version, although this particular bike has been spec with the twin exhaust that you get normally on the range topping R9T. In terms of electronics, they've really kept it visually to a minimum, so you've got a single round speedo with a little LCD insert in the middle, but it's not a big TFT slab like you get on a lot of modern bikes. But that said, under the hood, you do get two riding modes, so road and rain, lean sensitive ABS across the range as standard for 2021, traction control of course, dynamic brake control across the range as standard as well, so that kills the throttle under emergency braking so that you're not accidentally applying it, so a nice safety feature there. There's a USB socket as standard, and now LED lighting with a daytime running light and some really nice looking LED indicators and a nice looking tail light as well. Now you can spec it up with the optional extras, so a dynamic riding mode, lean sensitive traction control, cruise control, heated grips, engine drag torque control, so you can really take it up to that modern sports naked kind of spec, but it's all neatly hidden behind that retro clock. So who might buy this one? Well, of course, if you're looking for an R9T and you want the lowest starting price possible, then the R9T Pure is your friend. I've also mentioned that it's got a lower seat height than the Scrambler and the Urban GS at 805 mil. It's the lightest bike in the range, just by a couple of kilograms at 219 kilograms wet, and it's nice and narrow in the waist, so it makes for the most accessible version if you're a little bit shorter or perhaps a bit cautious around heavy bikes. Lastly, you know, this is the most plain looking one, the blank canvas, so if you're wanting to do a custom job, then I reckon this one would make a great starting point. And of course, if you're going to spend on custom parts, a new paint job, all that kind of thing, then the lowest price point probably helps as well. So moving up the range by a few hundred quid, we've got the R9T Scrambler, and it doesn't take a great brain to figure out what this bike's about. The specs are essentially the same as the Pure, but you've got all these little tweaks that just give it more of that off-roady Scrambler vibe. There's a bit more travel in the suspension, so 125 mil at the front, 140 mil at the front, that's up on the 120 front and rear on the Pure, and as such you get a taller bike at 820 mil in the seat height, and the bars are taller as well, so it gives you that more sat up position, scramblery feel to it, and that extra travel will be able to soak up some slightly bigger bumps. Now it does get a slightly different geometry as well, so the head angle is slightly more relaxed and that gives this bike better stability, although it will have a slower turn in. So the Pure will feel a little sharper on the road, this a bit more lazy, but gives you that stability on the rough stuff. It also gets some semi-off-road Bridgestone tyres and a 19-inch front wheel, so a bit more grip, and that front wheel should roll better over bumps and undulations. As standard, they are cast though, but this particular demo bike has been spec'd up with the spoke rims, which look absolutely stunning along with this paint job. There are a couple of nice little visual tweaks as well, so I've just mentioned the paint job, but you also get this tuck and roll style leather seat, which I think looks absolutely brilliant on this bike, and also the Akrapovic high level exhaust that gives it that signature scrambler look. Now look, if you want to do some proper adventure riding, then I'd thoroughly recommend checking out something like an F850 GS Adventure. But if you've got your heart set on a retro and you want to try some light gravel roads and that kind of thing, then obviously this is a better choice than the Pure. Second reason to buy this one is if you find the Pure that little bit too cramped. Taller riders might appreciate that extra height in the seat and also the height of the bars as well. So this offers a bit more space and definitely want to check out if you are on the tall side. Lastly, the third reason is that it just looks cool, like most scramblers do. So next up in the range we have this, the Urban GS. You get pretty much the same spec, all the same electronics, the same engine specs, the same suspension, but this one gets a bit of bodywork and paint that harks back to the original GSs that were ridden in the 80s. So you've got a high level front mudguard, a really cool looking headlight shroud that wraps around the clocks there, a few more kind of retro inspired distinctive paint jobs. On the standard version as well, you get a red saddle, and actually that's one of the only functional differences between this and the scrambler, is that the seat height goes up to 850mm. Unfortunately, you don't get the high level Akrapovic exhaust as standard on the Urban GS, just the single silencer, but you can spec it of course in the accessories catalog. So the first reason to go for the Urban GS like the scrambler is the looks, and I think for me personally this is the best looking one of the bunch. I really like the bodywork, I really like the paint jobs and the seat, and it just makes for a really cool looking retro bike. Second reason again is that the seat height goes up to 850mm, so if you're a super tall rider, perhaps if you're used to like an adventure bike kind of height, then this makes a great choice, especially if the others feel a little cramped. Third reason to buy the Urban GS is if you want something that looks a little special, because this is the only one that's available with this 40 years package. Now I've been borrowing this particular one from BMW HQ for the last couple of weeks, absolutely loved it, and there'll be a separate review on the channel, but here's a quick overview of what you get for your $2,500. So you get the Bumblebee paint job, inspired by the same paint job that you'll see back on the original R100 GS, yellow handguards, which I think look particularly good, you get the Option 719 machine cylinder head covers, spoked wheels as standard, and you can choose from gold rims or black, and you do get the high level Akrapovic exhaust as standard on this 40th edition. Now I guess this is probably only going to be available for this year, so if you do want something that's a little bit limited, then this is a great choice, and also if you want something that truly looks retro with this proper R100 GS paint job. So last up at the top of the range here, we've got the daddy of the R9T range, and this one is just called the R9T. Now this one has a proper road focus to it, so it has the same steering angle and the same seat height as the R9T Pure, but it has a few upgrades that just take it up a notch. The biggest one for me is the forks. So they're 46mm upside down forks, fully adjustable, and I borrowed one of these for a couple of weeks last year, and I've got to say it's a great handling bike. It rivals most modern sports nakeds. Now the brakes at the front are slightly better spec'd on this version as well, so although the braking performance is really good on the rest of the range, you get a little extra crispness from these radially mounted monoblock calipers. Electronically, this bike is pretty much the same as the others, but it does get twin clocks, so you get a rev counter. So of course, if you're pushing on a bit and riding in a more sporty manner, it can be useful to have a visual representation of where that peak power is. The rest of the differences are pretty much visual, so you get this nice natural brushed finish on the knee pad area there on the tank. Spoked wheels as standard, although this particular demo bike has the Option 719 premium spoke wheels, and then you also get the premium Akrapovic twin exhaust as standard on this one. So obviously go for this one if you do like like to do more sporty riding. Now you get the same power and torque, so the fundamentals are roughly the same, but that front fork will give you better feel when you're pushing on, and there's adjustability so that you can dial it in for your weight and riding style. The brakes do perform that little bit better, and you've got that rev counter, so it's a no-brainer for anyone who likes to ride a bit quicker. So that wraps things up for today. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you found this video interesting or useful. If you've got any questions, leave them in the comments below and I'll try and get back to you. And if you're new here and you want to see more videos like this, hit subscribe and I'll catch you next time.